We're going to begin our journey with an introduction to educational psychology. We're going to talk a little bit about the basic foundation of what it is and why we study it. The chapter that you read for today begins with the story of the wild boy who was found in the forest as an adolescent boy. The purpose of the story is to explain the importance of various aspects of learning, primarily social interaction. The boy is able to develop some of the knowledge and skills that typically developing young people do. However, the delay in interaction and learning severely inhibited his ability to learn so that he was never able to develop some skills. This early research pointed us towards some big ideas about educating people related to why we learn, how we learn, and some things that we need to consider in the educational process. 1. Motivation comes from the personal, social, and intellectual needs of the learner. 2. Educational techniques should be informed by scientific research. And 3. Learner characteristics should influence educational programs. Behavior is focused on the impact that instructional manipulations have on students' outcome performance. Behaviorists look at learning in terms of observable changes in behavior that are relatively durable. In other words, a behaviorist has to see something in order to decide whether or not the instruction was useful.
Cognitivists also look at instructional manipulations, but they take into account individual differences that learners have that may impact learning. Cognitivists also focus on the learning process and outcomes on the way to outcome performance, looking at the influence of instruction in the memory processes of attention encoding retrieval and how these processes result in the new knowledge that is demonstrated by performance. We will be focusing largely on the cognitivist viewpoint throughout this course.
Take a look at the diagram in the chapter that shows the differences in the two views in the relation between instructional manipulations like teaching and the resulting outcome performance of the student. Table 1.1 in the chapter also shows some examples of the types of instructional manipulations, learner characteristics, learning processes, and outcomes that lead to the outcome performance that is the overall goal of instruction, which is retention and transfer of knowledge. Now that we know a couple of the viewpoints, what do educational psychologists actually do? Well, we are scientists, but not quite like these. Educational psychologists study different kinds of instructional manipulations and how they affect students' learning. The goals are to help students develop knowledge as a base in which to connect new information and to help students effectively connect new knowledge with existing information. Speaking of knowledge, let's talk about how we define it. Gaining knowledge is part of learning, and the overall goal of teaching is to help students gain knowledge, retain it, and transfer to new context. But what are the kinds of knowledge? First is semantic, Velasca. Procedural, how do you calculate 160 divided by 4? And strategic, what's my plan or how am I going to accomplish my goal? So if our goal is to develop knowledge, and now we know what kinds of knowledge we're talking about, the next question is, where do we store it? The easy answer is our memory. We'll talk more about memory in the next few lessons. There are four terms that you're probably already familiar with: sensory memory, working memory, short-term memory, and long-term memory. The part of the memory that we'll focus the most on is working memory. This brings us to the question, how do we get knowledge into memory? There are four processes involved that are part of learning. First is attention. We have to focus on the thing we want to remember. Then we have rehearsal. This is repetition to keep content active in working memory. If we keep new knowledge active long enough, encoding takes place. This is where we transfer content to long-term memory. Finally, we have searching and retrieval. This involves finding and pulling back previously encoded material into working memory for use with some new knowledge. This is a diagram of our memory system. Basically, what it's telling us is that information comes into sensory memory first. This is really, really, really short-term memory, heavily dependent on our senses. If we don't take a moment to move this information into working memory through attending to it, it's gone. Information that we do pay attention to and move into working memory still has a short shelf life. Working memory holds information for less than 18 seconds. Some say even less than that. We have a couple of things we can do to keep information in working memory. One of these is the process of rehearsal, like when you tell yourself a phone number over and over until you get to where you can dial it so you can keep it active. Working memory also helps us engage in elaborative rehearsal, which is the beginning of process of encoding. This is where we connect the new information to something we already knew using the memory processes we talked about a little while ago. Finally, long-term memory is where we store our memories for the long term. As you can see, there are several different stages where content can be lost or forgotten. We'll learn more about forgetting later. There are three conditions required to gain knowledge. The first condition that is required is reception. In other words, the thing has to be available so that you can receive and attend to it. The second condition is availability. This means that the learner needs to have some relevant pre-existing knowledge that it can be used to connect to the new information. This is what helps us make sense of new information and figure out how to store it. The third condition is activation, and this is where the learner's new knowledge and existing knowledge are combined to create meaning. These processes are the way schema are developed. We're going to talk more about schema in the next unit. The big ideas we cover today include an introduction to the science of educational psychology. This is a science dedicated to uncovering the processes involved in learning and instructional methods and strategies to improve learning outcomes for all students. We also introduced two theoretical points of view, behaviorist and cognitivist, and talked a little bit about how they are different. Finally, we introduced the types of knowledge, the cognitive processes involved in learning, and what conditions must be met for people to learn and get information into memory. We'll continue with memory, remembering, and forgetting later in the semester.